Amici di Sportface, buonasera e benvenuti a questo nuovo appuntamento dedicato al running. Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to this new live on running. Allora, questa sera una puntata davvero speciale perché ho l'onore di avere con me il vincitore dell'ultima edizione della 100 km del Passatore. Tonight for me is a real pleasure because I have the honor of having here with me the winner of the last edition of the 100 km, the 100 km of the Passatore. It's a real pleasure that I say welcome to Lee Grantham. Ciao Lee and thank you for being here tonight.
Grazie mille, Fabrizio. Grazie
Ok, allora, first of all, as a forward, I have to say that it's the first time that I try to make an interview in English and then translate into Italian. So for me, usually it's difficult to speak in Italian, so it will be even more difficult to speak in English also because the level of my English is worse than the level of my running. It's not easy, but it's the reality. So I beg you pardon if the translation won't and my accent won't be perfect, but we will try to do our best. Come premesso, ovviamente, è la prima volta che mi trovo a fare, proviamo a fare un'intervista in inglese con la traduzione in italiano, quindi cercheremo, mi perdonerete, il mio livello di inglese è probabilmente anche peggiore del mio livello di corsa, anche se non è facile, mi perdonerete e cercheremo di fare del nostro meglio. I remind you before starting that we are live, so any question or comment that may come to Lee, is more than welcome. We say hello to Tiziana, is already connected, and to Sandro Marconi, who is saying ciao Gesù. Ciao Gesù.
Ciao.
Sandro Marconi is our friend photographer who has taken a lot of nice photos to Lee during the race. Short presentation before starting, una breve presentazione di Lee prima di partire. British, 39 years old, he won the 100 km of the Passatore 42 years after the last British winning, who was Donald Ritchie, won twice in 1979 and 1980. Lee won in 7 hours, 3 minutes, and 42 seconds. So he will be here with us to talk about the race, but to talk also about his lifestyle and diet, next challenges, and anyone else. La breve presentazione ha vinto ovviamente il Passatore 42 anni dopo Donald Ritchie, che è stato l'ultimo inglese a trionfare sul traguardo di Faenza. E Ritchie vinse nel 79 e nell'80. Parleremo con Neil di tutto della gara, con Lee, scusate, della gara, ma anche di altre cose, della sua dieta, del suo stile di vita, del training, eccetera, eccetera. Quindi iniziamo subito la nostra intervista. Lee, one important question, the first one. You know that in Italy, football is one of the most important things. Not for me because I am not so passionate, but for many of the people, football is very important. You are from Manchester. When I am asked City or United, you told me Oldham Athletics. So we want to know something about this team. Quindi, Nile di Manchester, il calcio in Italia è importante, né City, né Manchester United, ma Oldham Athletics. Neil.
First of all, you can't change your team, right? And
No,
so
I
my
can't.
father supported Oldham Athletic, so I have to support Oldham Athletic. So in the Premier League, for example, Roma would be Manchester United, AC Milan would be, for example, Oldham Athletic. This type of
No, that's fine. I think we have a problem with this interview tonight.
That's the answer, I'm sticking with it.
Okay, no, stava dicendo giustamente Neil prima che. So, before leaving you and closing the interview, because I am very, very angry with you, no, stava dicendo che lui ovviamente non si può cambiare la squadra del padre. Suo padre tifava per l'Oldham Athletic, e questa squadra che attualmente insomma in quinta divisione in Inghilterra, e quindi l'Oldham Athletic a livello del Milan, e il Manchester United invece in alto a livello della Roma. Insomma, mi stava prendendo un po' in giro per la mia passione per il Milan. Let's start talking about running then. Lee, when we talk for the first time, taking the agreement for this interview, you said Passatore was really something wonderful. Wonderful in Firenze, wonderful in Faenza. So I ask you to tell us your best memories of this race and of this experience.
I mean, the entire thing from reading Don Ritchie's autobiography maybe 10 years ago to wanting to come to Firenze to start the 100K, to following Giorgio over the last 10 years, and following the winners of Passatore, which has mainly been Giorgio, to the history of the race. I think these races are so much more than just competitions. And it's the perfect way to see that part of Italy, like from Firenze to Faenza. My experience was just incredibly beautiful, whether it was the villages, the support from the people along the way, and the amount of volunteers as well that support the race and make it the wonderful event that it is. It's incredible. It really is incredible. I've raced all over the world, and maybe this is top two or three, yeah, easily.
Okay. Ha detto che è un po' una combinazione di cause, quindi dal fatto di aver letto la biografia di Donald Ritchie qualche anno fa, di aver seguito la corsa nell'ultimo decennio e quindi di aver visto le imprese di Re Giorgio Calcaterra, che è stato poi un po' il monopolizzatore di questa gara con le sue 12 vittorie consecutive, un Re Giorgio che quest'anno ha conquistato comunque anche, è tornato sul podio conquistando il terzo gradino del podio, ma poi anche la storia proprio di questa gara, l'atmosfera che va oltre la competizione sportiva, il fatto di poter vedere questa parte d'Italia, il supporto dei paesi, il supporto, il tifo che ha incontrato in tutti i paesi, l'aiuto dei volontari, tutto questo ha reso di fatto incredibile il suo ingresso in Faenza. Just describe for us how was from a competition standpoint the race. So how we approach it, how it goes, and when you did start thinking that maybe it was the good year to win it. Quindi descrivici da un punto di vista proprio agonistico come è stata la gara, come sei partito, come l'hai affrontata e quando hai cominciato anche a capire che forse poteva essere l'anno giusto per vincere.
Well, it's funny because you travel to these events and you maybe travel to America, you maybe travel to Italy, but when you get on a plane and travel to a race, especially if you're at the competitive side, then you're only really thinking about the win. You're only really thinking, how do I win this? And how do I beat the best of Italy in Italy, you know? So then it becomes just a mental game. And so initially we set off really slowly, but it was hot. It was hot from the very beginning. It was hot in the square, Piazza del Duomo. And the hotter it got, the more chance I have, because I can survive in the heat really well. And so when we approached 10, 20, 30 kilometers, we gone past Fisoli, up the first climb, people were already sweating a lot. And so from there, I didn't mean to go to the front after 30K. It just happened. And I would have preferred to share some more kilometers with Giorgio. This is for me a real experience. And then go later. The plan was to go easy to 50K, then go really hard the last 50K. But naturally, I went to the front. There was a gap, and I was alone for the rest of the race. Yeah.
Okay. Dice che quando si viaggia per questi eventi e quando si compete per vincere, l'unico pensiero che si ha è proprio quello della vittoria. Diventa quasi un mental game, un gioco mentale. Quindi il giorno della gara è partito con molta cautela, anche perché faceva molto caldo, faceva caldo a Firenze in piazza prima della partenza. Effettivamente ci sono stati tanti ritiri quest'anno al Passatore. Ha visto che già dopo il passaggio a Fiesole, poi dopo sulla prima salita c'era già gente in difficoltà e non era pianificato di essere in vantaggio già dopo 30 chilometri, ma è successo spontaneamente. Il suo piano era di partire partire con calma, rimanere in gruppo principalmente con Giorgio Calcaterra almeno fino al 50° chilometro, ma già dopo 30 chilometri si è trovato da solo e quindi c'era un vantaggio e l'ha gestito per il resto della gara. Is there been any moment in which you said maybe I am running too quickly, in which you fear to lose the position?
So after 30K you're alone. And so this means in El Pasatore that the only chaser of you is the course director in a car, and then a procession of many vehicles, many cars, many motorbikes, many cyclists. Mm-hmm. And I had to stop to stretch a couple of times. I never had to do this in a race, I think three times. And in one of the times I stretch, I thought, okay, finish. This is enough, I'm dead. And this old lady, this old Italian lady, she come up to me and she said, come here, Ben. So I go really close, I lean in, and she whispers in my ear. I still to this day don't know the words because it's in Italian, so maybe you can translate. She said, O partigiano, portami via. Bella ciao, partigiano, portami via. Mi sento di more. Now I didn't know what that meant.
There is no need of translation with the is a song which is internationally recognized.
I didn't know what it meant, but I think she told me get to the finish as fast as you can, then you can win El Pasatore, the biggest race in Italy. Maybe.
Very good. Now after your song of Bella Ciao, you have lost completely what you have said and what I had to translate, but I will try again. You know, Bella Ciao was it's really famous in Italy because it's a song of the Second World War.
Yeah.
But it became very very famous also for La Casa de Papel because yeah. It was by the way there was some scene done in Florence. Stavo dicendo di Bella Ciao, che è stata anche divenuta famosa in una delle puntate più belle della Casa di Carta. Allora, just to translate, the comments and questions are coming, so I am becoming a little bit crazy. I don't know in which language I am speaking, guys. So please, stavo dicendo che stanno arrivando moltissime domande e commenti. Lui dice, ho dovuto fermarmi due o tre volte a fare stretching, non mi era mai quasi mai successo, quindi in quel momento forse ho avuto un attimo di difficoltà, perché quando poi ti trovi da solo al 40° chilometro davanti a te hai soltanto la macchina della gara e quindi è difficile, però poi con l'aiuto anche di Bella Ciao è andato dritto fino al traguardo. There is a question from allora two questions, ci sono due domande. But before the two questions, there is also Massimo Giacopuzzi connected. I have a question that is coming to me right now. Mm-hmm. Ho una domanda che mi è venuta in mente adesso che voglio fare. I want to ask you what you think and how you feel when a person is ahead of the race, is the first in the race, and in front of him there is just the car of the race director, because for one as me it's a sensation, it's a sort of emotion that I will never try. Maybe I will try the emotion of the ambulance at the end of the queue, but what do you feel? Because if I am in your shoes, my first thing is, and now what the hell I have to do?
Yeah, this is what I'm thinking. So this is not in the race plan. It's 100K, so it's a long way. It's not even a marathon. It's much longer, yeah? So really, this comes down to the last 2 hours, maybe the last 25K. So I'm exactly where I don't want to be too early in the race. But what do? You stop and wait? Do you go slowly? So all these things come into your head. And then ultimately, I thought and I wrote after the race that I wanted to go to Pastore and win the race, but in an honest time. So if I go and win in the race in 7:30, this isn't, it's not a good winning time. So no disrespect to anybody else, but the times that Giorgio has won in have always been fast. And maybe this was a hot year and I should have ran faster, but I didn't in my head run a smart race.
So dice, io gli ho chiesto che cosa si pensa quando si è primi e davanti a sé si ha solo la macchina della direzione di gara, e quindi ho detto, se io mai mi trovassi, io al limite mi trovo dietro con l'ambulanza, ma se mai mi trovassi primo non saprei cosa fare, direi adesso che cazzo sto facendo, che sono qua primo, non so come muovermi. E lui a suo modo dice, beh, è un po' anche come mi ci sono trovato io, no? Perché mi sono trovato dove non pensavo di essere, dove non avevo pianificato di essere, ovvero in testa alla gara troppo presto, e quindi che cosa si fa quando si è in quella posizione? Non è che si può fermarsi ed aspettare oppure rallentare, bisogna correre, anche perché diceva i tempi con cui ha vinto Giorgio Calcaterra in passato erano tempi veramente notevoli, quindi vincere il passatore in 7:30, ovviamente con tutto rispetto per chi lo fa e lo ha fatto, è una cosa, vincerlo con un tempo più basso può essere anche un'altra cosa. I stop one moment my list of questions, because there are questions from the people at home, so I want to leave them also the space to ask. Quindi do un attimo, scusate ragazzi, sto facendo del mio meglio, sono già stanco, do un attimo spazio a chi sta scrivendo da casa. Massimo Giacopuzzi, Massimo is perfect. Is even making the question in English, so it's even helping me as much as he can, so I can just read it. Lee, in Italy we have a lot of wonderful places to visit, sea, mountains, lake, monuments. Just last year you had to run the race, so why you didn't go to the seaside instead of running the race, is asking Massimo, because
because
he's making you congratulations, of course, and he said it was nice to meet you.
Yeah, it was wonderful to meet him, and so kind to me after the race. But if I would have gone to the seaside, then he would have had to do all these interviews 3 weeks after the race. I'm trying to save him time.
Ok. Yeah. Quindi Massimo dice che se lui andava al mare ti toccava l'intervista stasera, quindi ti ha salvato un po' di tempo. Allora, Sandro Marconi is asking, some years ago, if I am not wrong, Lee got retired from the race after 25-30 kilometers. 40. He was ahead and he had a problem. Is that true? And what happened in that race?
First, Sandro, the pictures you take are wonderful, and thank you for the memories. I really appreciate that. 2018, I came and things were really easy until 40K, and my plan was similar. Do the climb as fast as possible and then descend and then go hard the last 40. But at 40K, I rolled my ankle, and we had also the World Championships later that year. So I decided to retire. But from that, I really wanted to come back. And but of course, then we had COVID. 2020, 2021 was a problem as well. So yeah, I really wanted to come back and put right what was wrong. Mm.
Okay.
Well, thank you for both those, the main thing.
Dice, innanzitutto ringrazia Sandro per le foto che Sandro ha fatto, che sono ricordi bellissimi, e lo sono per tutti noi, perché Sandro è veramente un artista nel fare le foto e poi per presentarle in maniera veramente emozionante. Sì, effettivamente nel 2018 ha avuto questo problema, e non è riuscito a interpretare la gara come avrebbe voluto, ha deciso di ritirarsi anche perché poi successivamente c'era un appuntamento importante, però da quel giorno il suo pensiero è sempre stato quello di tornare. Ovviamente ha potuto farlo quando il discorso del Covid e della pandemia glielo ha concesso. There is another question lì from Antonio Abruzzese, who is the admin of Bologna Running, a very well-known group, running group of Facebook. Antonio is asking, if I am not wrong, sto leggendo la domanda di Antonio Abruzzese, ragazzi, quindi leggetevela direttamente così non me la traduco. So read the question for the Italian guy so I don't have to do the translation. If I am not wrong, in the past, Lee was a trailer, was running trails. In order to participate and be competitive for the victory at the Passatore, considering the shape of the race and so on, which kind of background has to have a top runner? So it's important having an experience on the trail, or just making standard races on street, or what is your talk about that?
I think for me, I like to run, so I don't mind if it's running on the trail or running on the road, but it must be runnable, not technical trail like UTMB where you're climbing and you need to carry things. Running, I like to run, and so this can be smooth trail, or it can be in the mountains, or it can be flat road. But Il Passatore is very simple to train for. You need to be fast on the flat, you need to be fast going uphill, and you need to be fast going downhill. It's very simple.
It's simple, so it's just to apply. No, dice molto. Allora, yes. Lui principalmente. Anil, sì, Anil, I don't know why I'm calling you Neil. I don't know. I'm getting crazy. Ali,
you can call me Susan if it makes you happy. You know that film?
Sorry for that. It's a real mistake. Ali piace principalmente correre, quindi che sia trail, che sia strada, l'importante è correre. Ovviamente lui non corre trail particolarmente tecnici, quali può essere l'UTMB, l'Ultra Trail du Mont Blanc, eccetera. Comunque l'importante è correre. E poi dice la caratteristica che bisogna avere per vincere il Passatore è molto semplice: bisogna essere veloci in pianura, veloci in salita e veloci in discesa. Quindi quando si è veloci in queste tre condizioni si primeggia. We say hello also to Christian Calabrese. He's a friend, he's an ultra runner who is following our live and is asking me to pass his compliments to you.
Grazie.
Neil, for the... What about entering in Faenza? What have you tried in terms of emotion when you entered and you saw the finish line and all the people, all the guys and all the kids all around?
Yeah, incredible. And this goes on for maybe 3 kilometers before. So constantly you have the police, you have the sirens, you have the crowds on either side. But really, I couldn't relax until I crossed the finish line because my body was, my legs were in bits, as we say. Like, I wasn't comfortable at all. So, and I had no clue for 70 kilometers how far behind second place was. So I didn't know where Massimo was, who was in second. I couldn't relax. I didn't know whether they were 500 meters or 3 kilometers or 4 kilometers. I didn't have a clue. So when I eventually crossed the finish line, I think you can see on the video, I shake my head in kind of disbelief, because I really thought, how the fuck did that happen? That's exactly what I felt. Like, how did that just happen? Because I was so uncomfortable so early. Just didn't feel, it felt surreal. And then the Faenza was on fire. It was just a carnival. It was a party. It was an unbelievable atmosphere, yeah. A memory I'll never forget.
Allora, dice che è stato un qualcosa di indimenticabile. già il tutto, diciamo, i festeggiamenti erano già presenti anche da 3 chilometri prima del traguardo, perché c'erano le macchine della polizia e tutto, però lui di fatto è rimasto concentrato fino agli ultimi metri, perché per 70 chilometri non aveva idea esattamente di dove fosse, di quanto sarebbe stato, era il suo vantaggio sul secondo, di dove si trovava, a che distanza si trovava Massimo Giacopuzzi, eccetera. Quindi fino veramente all'ultimo secondo è rimasto concentratissimo sulla gara, e poi quando non appena ha superato il traguardo ha shakerato un po' la sua testa e ha detto: che cazzo è successo? Perché poi traduco letteralmente, più o meno ha usato la stessa espressione, quasi quasi incredulo di aver ottenuto questa vittoria in un contesto così magico. E le emozioni di Faenza, i ricordi di Faenza li porterà dentro per sempre. Stanno arriving a lot of questions, Lee. So if you like, I leave space to the people asking asking questions from home. I am very happy. I am very happy that there are a lot of questions. So it's very good. Sandro Marconi, come traduco rompicoglioni? What are your memory in Faenza with the kicks? Rompicoglioni all'arrivo, breaking your balls at the arrival. You understand? What are your memories in the?
Yeah, you know, when everything is in Italian or in a different language, the whole world may be as well be silent, but you understand some affection, yeah. And for me, the most important thing about sport is getting children into sport from an early age and keeping them in sport when maybe life gets a little bit difficult. So the fact that they'd organized for X amount of children to hundreds of children to run the entire course, and the planning and organization that goes behind that, sensational. And then of course, you obviously get a lot of children breaking your balls, but I don't know what's being said, so I cannot be offended.
Ok, dice quindi parto dalla cosa più importante, dal messaggio più autentico che ha lasciato lì con questa risposta, ovvero che la cosa più importante dello sport is to get children into the sport, cioè portare i bambini nello sport fin dalla giovane età, perché poi lo sport può essere un aiuto durante i momenti difficili della vita. Questo io penso che sia una grandissima verità. Quindi il fatto che ci fossero tantissimi bambini per lui è semplicemente una cosa, che l'organizzazione abbia previsto questo è una cosa assolutamente fantastica. Poi dice: tanto non era la mia lingua, quindi qualsiasi cosa abbiano detto io non ne sono stato assolutamente disturbato. So, a lot of questions. I try not to lose anyone. He's making compliments also Marco Visentini, who is our Italian champion of the 24 hour.
Grazie.
Marco has run 265 kilometers more or less in 24 wow. hours. So, Marco is passing you his compliments. Paola is asking, I'm trying to translate, how much is important the talent, how much versus the training and versus the mental strongness to win the passatore. So talent, training, mindset, what is more important to win the passatore, and or if there is anything which is all three aspects are important at the same time?
It is a very good question. I think, in my opinion, you have to have some genetic help. But the further you go, the more it's to do with the mind, not just in the race, but your mental preparation in terms of the training, consistently putting in high volumes of weeks. and the right training, smart training, smart, knowing when to hold back. I'd say it's like, it feels like 10% genetic, and the rest is mental. But the mental side also controls the level of training you can consistently do over months and years.
Allora, dice che sicuramente ci deve essere un qualcosa di genetico, un talento innato che ti... E questo o ce l'hai o non ce l'hai, almeno diciamo il 10% secondo lui è talento. Tutto il resto è preparazione mentale che ti spinge ad andare avanti, a costruire settimana dopo settimana un volume di allenamento appropriato, ma preparazione mentale che ti fa capire anche quale sia il livello appropriato di allenamento che tu puoi permetterti di costruire.
Altra cosa, another thing though, but at the same point, if you watch the 1500 meters recently in Bislett in Norway, and you have the young Norwegian kid who's doing the 1500 meters, he only has to run for 3 minutes and 46 seconds. But this is 90% mental as well. He's obviously come with an incredible genetic base. But the mental game to show up consistently on that spot and win by milliseconds, again, this is, maybe you could argue that the mental side is also genetic, but for me, that's incredible. Same with boxing, same with fighting. It's the mental game. It's kind of the difference between the winners and everybody else. And that's not me putting myself into that category, but you could talk about Giorgio and say, well, he must have something, big lungs, big heart, great blood. Giorgio has an incredible mind consistently over many, many years to do this well.
Wow. I was so excited in listening your comments that I lost to try to do the translation. I tried to remind. Dice nei 1500 metri che si sono corsi poco tempo fa, il ragazzo norvegese, non chiedetemi di dire il nome perché non lo so dire, però sapete tutti di chi sto parlando. Anche lì, anche per correre i 1500 metri, anche per correre un 1500 in pista, è fondamentale la preparazione mentale, quindi l'aspetto mentale, anche per chi fa sport di lotta, eccetera, è questo che fa la differenza tra chi vince e chi non vince. Lui non si mette tra i vincenti in maniera anche modesta, secondo me, ma parla di un vincente per natura che è Giorgio Calcaterra. Uno può pensare che Giorgio abbia un grande cuore, grandi polmoni, una grande predisposizione naturale, ma secondo lui, probabilmente è vero, la forza più grande di Giorgio Calcaterra è la forza mentale che lo spinge ad andare oltre a ottenere i suoi traguardi. Other questions. Fabio May is making his compliments and is saying, which will be your next races? You will be running again in Italy, and which is the distance in which you feel more, which is your distance in which you feel more competitive?
I feel most comfortable in, grazie by the way, but I feel most comfortable in 100K. And so the next race I'll do is the World Championships 100K in Germany, in Berlin.
Berlin.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Very good. So you answer also a question from Sandro Marconi, who is asking if you go in Berlin in August for the championship.
I have a question for Sandro. Will he be there taking photos? If so, can he be on the right side so I look my most beautiful?
Chiede se Sandro sarà là a fare le foto, di mettersi dal lato migliore per prendergli le foto migliori sul suo lato più fotogenico. So it is not of no interest for anyone, but I will be in Berlin as well, maybe if I try to arrive not injured, because it's also a master championship, so maybe we can do a live directly from Berlin at the end of the race. Quindi dice che la sua distanza è la 100 km, quindi sarà il campionato del mondo della 100 km che si, su strada, che si correrà il prossimo 27 agosto a Birnau, nei pressi, a una quarantina di chilometri da Berlino, e quindi si preannuncia una gara molto importante e ci sarà una nuova sfida di nuovo anche con il nostro Massimo Giacopuzzi. You will be again against Massimo Giacopuzzi, because Massimo is one of the selected person from the Italian national team. Another question from Donne Ultra. Sorry, Lee, I think we won't be able to follow my list of questions because they're arriving
a lot of questions.
Donne Ultra, la traduco prima in italiano because the question is in English. Ti aspettavi così, così tanta gente all'arrivo, al traguardo? Questo non è molto comune nel mondo delle ultra. Ti senti come una rockstar. Did you expect all that crowd at the finish line? This is not very common in the ultra world. Do you feel like a rockstar?
I feel like a rockstar every day. because that's my lifestyle, but this is a special feeling when you come to Faenza, a very special feeling, and it's such a perfect place because it's the piazza, the restaurants, the perfect time of night, the race starts at the perfect time, everything just fits really well. This should be a race that's 10 times the size, you know.
Ok, quindi dice che lui si sente una rock star non solo in quel frangente, ma un po' nella vita, perché è il suo modo di interpretare la vita, ma poi in Faenza è stato veramente l'apoteosi nel sentirsi una rock star, perché è stato veramente, veramente tutto perfetto all'arrivo, la corsa è partita nel momento giusto, quindi veramente un evento perfetto. Luigi Del Buono is saying sono pienamente d'accordo, la mente è molto in tutte le discipline, so is in agreement with you on the fact that the mental aspect is key, and he is asking how many kilometers you do every week and in which percentage of intensity.
Oh, good question. Yeah, so Very low for somebody who runs marathons or ultra marathons. I spend, a perfect week for me is 15 hours training on the bike and running, and 6 hours on the bike, 9 hours running. And within that, I maybe do, a perfect week is 100 kilometers on running and 120 on the bike. Yeah. Not a great deal, and four times in the gym. But for me, I always wanted to be my career to be sustainable, like not push it. And I think recently you kind of realize with experience that if you can make the start line, that competitive instinct inside of you is so strong that even if you're just at 80%, you have a chance. Whereas if you get injured along the way to the race, you have no chance.
Oh, this is important. And now I take note because I want to explain better what you have said. So, scusate, parlo in italiano, adesso traduco. Dice non eccessivo in termini di chilometraggio, quindi di solito idealmente 15 ore a settimana suddivise tra 6 ore di bici e 9 ore di corsa, condite poi da 4 sedute in palestra. Di solito in queste 6 ore di bici lui fa circa 120 km, mentre nelle 9 ore in cui corre fa circa 100 km a settimana, che magari non è il chilometraggio che ci si potrebbe aspettare da un atleta che prepara le ultra al suo livello. Quello che lui dice è un aspetto molto importante, cioè il fatto di evitare infortuni, perché se tu riesci ad arrivare bene sulla linea di partenza, mentalmente puoi vincere anche se sei all'80% delle tue possibilità o della tua condizione fisica, mentre se sei infortunato, che chiaramente non puoi competere. Quindi è molto importante sapersi gestire. Alicia Calderone is an Italian ultra runner. Ultra runner. Sorry for my accent, which is very terrible.
I love it. Like Roberto Benigni.
Sì, like Roberto Benigni. It's the same. Sandro, basta. Sandro Marconi is asking a question about beer, but we will do it later on. Beer, the title of the question of Sandro Marconi is beer in Berlin. Now I will ask him later on. Sto scherzando, Sandro, fai tutte le domande che vuoi. Alicia is asking, and now we are at 40 minutes of live. I have said 30 minutes. Lee, if you just can leave us some minutes, no problem, because you see no that problem. There are a lot of questions. It is a sort of unique opportunity to having you here with me and with us. Alicia is asking, which mental characteristic is important? Determination, capability to suffer? What do you mean? Resilienza? I don't know how to translate resilience. I will try with the translation.
Resilience.
Sometimes it's the easier that you can find. So resilience. What is the main proper when you talk about mental? What do you mean? Is the capacity of suffering, the resilience? What else?
It's your mental plan. So all of what she has just said is true. So you have to, it's not a case whether you may suffer or not during the race. You are going to suffer. It's just about when. So how long do you suffer for, and what does suffering mean for you? Do you see it as pain, which it's definitely not, or do you see it as something you can embrace, which means that you are alive and you get to choose to suffer, which is, if we flip the perspective on that, it's incredibly fortunate. We get to choose that we suffer, when around the world, many people don't get that choice. They are suffering without an option. So if you get to wake up, run for 7 hours, and part of that is suffering, this is pleasure. It's just the way you look at it.
I have to translate it, but I don't like to ruin this answer because it's really fantastic. Dice, bisogna capire, innanzitutto è chiaro che in una corsa del genere in qualche modo si debba soffrire. Prima o poi in momenti di crisi la sofferenza arrivano, bisogna solo stabilire quando. E poi bisogna anche che noi ci chiariamo su che cosa significa soffrire. Se è dolore fisico, allora certamente no, come dice giustamente Teresa nei commenti, sono partita con un dolore fisico e mi sono dovuta fermare. Ma se la sofferenza è la è un qualcosa con cui che tu scegli di fare, con cui tu puoi convivere, embracing, dice, cioè tu la puoi anche abbracciare, allora è un qualcosa, tu devi cambiare la tua prospettiva, perché poi noi alla fine ci alziamo un giorno, facciamo 7 ore nel suo caso, che è bravo, o anche molte di più nel nostro ore di corsa e basta, mentre c'è gente, e noi questa la chiamiamo sofferenza, mentre c'è gente che non ha scelta nella vita, nel mondo, e che deve soffrire per forza. Quindi noi scegliamo di soffrire, e quindi questo ci può, è una nostra scelta consapevole, e si può andare anche oltre, proprio con questa capacità tra virgolette di soffrire. I hope I was able to translate your wonderful answer. There is a question from Saverio Fattori. Ciao Saverio, journalist, writer on Correre, published a lot of books and so on. Is putting another perspective. He's saying Benati, the first trainer of Stefano Baldini, the Olympic champion on the marathon of Athens, Italian Olympic champion marathon in Athens in 2004, is getting angry when you say a lot on the mental strongness in of Stefano, while underlining that it was more talent and physically strong. So it's like to say the mental aspect is not so important. Maybe it's something is a different point of view. So the physical, the talent, and is not only 10%, but it may be even more. My personal view is that watching him, that Stefano Baldini was mentally more than stronger, I have to say. But this is just my personal view. Okay.
Does this require an answer or my comment? Yeah.
Yes, if you like.
Well, maybe he's right. Yeah, but the thing is, you ever heard, what is the term in Italy where you play with the hand that you're dealt, like in poker? You can only play with the cards that you're dealt, right? What it means in life is, you can only play the hand that you're dealt in poker, right? You cannot play any other hands.
Okay. In the poker, the card that you have in your hand, okay.
So whether you have incredible genetics or not, what you do with them is what counts, right? There's no real change in, even the VO2 max, there's no real change in that. You can change it, it's a tiny, tiny bit, but not much. So this is your starting point, everything on from there. So what happened before you were born, I mean, maybe in athletics or sport or music, whatever, you could say the greatest thing you could do to be the best pianist in the world or the best runner is to pick the right parents. You have to choose the right parents. What can you do about that? So you have to only move forward. You can only move forward. To look back is almost is irrelevant, yeah?
Quindi sottolinea ancora una volta il fatto che è un po' come nel poker, che uno può solo giocare con le carte che ha in mano, deve cercarsi di costruire la fortuna con la sua determinazione. L'aspetto mentale è fortissimo, perché anche il discorso del VO2 max eccetera eccetera si può migliorare, ma è chiaro che mentalmente la forza mentale è quella che dal suo punto di vista può veramente fare la differenza, perché poi per essere un bravo runner o un bravo calciatore, la miglior cosa che si può fare prima di nascere è scegliersi i parenti giusti, quindi nascere figlio di calciatore o figlio di runner. Però poi dopo conta anche quanto mentalmente si vuole arrivare a una certa a un certo livello. I take the opportunity that is getting connected right now with us, Antonio.
Just on that, listen, that is only my opinion, and I'm just a runner, so you know, yeah.
Questo ovviamente lui dice, questa è la mia opinione personale, poi è chiaro che Benati ha dei punti di vista, o c'è gente che ha altri punti di vista. Of course. I take the opportunity that Antonio Di Manno is connected. Antonio Di Manno is an Italian ultra runner, is a specialist of the so-called backyard ultra marathon. He won the Italian version of the backyard ultra marathon, l'ultimo sopravvissuto, the last survivor. He won a lot of ultra marathon like la Milano Sanremo and other races, and one of the characteristic of Antonio is his vegan diet. So he's very all this is way of life, and his way of making sport is centered about, let's say, a vegan approach. More than vegan diet, maybe I am saying it better. So I know that you have a sort of almost vegan diet or almost vegan style, if you can describe it. Just I make the translation of what I have said. Approfitto del discorso che c'è Antonio Di Manno collegato per parlare un po' del discorso dell'alimentazione vegana e della dieta vegana. Okay.
It is for 7 years vegan, and since November, one meal per week has meat in it. So this may be the worst thing in the world for vegan people, but without a doubt, it's the right movement ethically for the world. Without a doubt, the recovery benefits and energy benefits are there There is some planning you need to do to get the right amino acid profile. Much more complicated than just getting the right macronutrient of protein, which is often the debate. It's always worked for me. I think the world should all eat less meat, and we should kind of move that industry of agriculture away as much as possible. Yeah, without a doubt. And I feel strongly about it. But I'm not a hypocrite. I have one meal a week which contains meat.
Okay. Quindi dice il mio stile di vita, la mia alimentazione è da 7 anni è fondamentalmente vegana. Ho dovuto però introdurre un pasto a settimana che contiene un piccolo quantitativo di carne. Questo potrà sembrare per un vegano la cosa peggiore del mondo, probabilmente, ma è un requisito che lui ha dovuto adottare. Certamente quello che ci tiene a ribadire è che questo stile di vita, questo approccio è a suo modo di vedere l'approccio corretto verso cui deve andare il mondo, devono andare le prossime generazioni, quindi una riduzione dell'uso del consumo di carne, perché i benefici dal suo punto di vista sono lì e sono assolutamente evidenti. We say hello also to another big ultramarathoner Italian as a friend, Michele Melnome, who is asking me to pass his compliments. I think two things, next challenges, two last questions. We said half an hour, we are almost in 1 hour. I thank you for all your passion tonight. There was a lot of questions, so I wanted to leave the space to anyone. I am just checking if I propose the question that all the people have done so far. Two questions. Your next challenges, you said August, the
World Champs.
World Champs in Germany, and then after that you have already any plan, or which is your objective in that race, and then your goal, your target, and then if you have already any plan for the prosecution of the season.
The goal is to win that race, and then after that race go to 50 kilometers in October, maybe in Spain, 50 kilometer European Championships. Again, if I can get a place and try to get towards our British record is now very strong, but try to get towards the British record in this.
Okay.
It's held by a friend of mine, and it's a strong record. I think 249, 247 maybe.
240. Okay. Yeah. So allora dice il suo prossimo obiettivo ovviamente è il campionato del mondo che si terrà a Berlino il 27 agosto. Il suo obiettivo, qui si vede il coraggio di dichiarare anche gli obiettivi, di vincere questa gara, quindi lo dice con molto 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 apertamente. Dopodiché il prossimo obiettivo stagionale potrebbe essere in ottobre il campionato europeo dei 50 chilometri, dove il suo obiettivo potrebbe essere quello, sarebbe quello di battere il record inglese, che in 2:47, 2:49 sta andando a memoria, quindi poi magari lo controlliamo, ci guardiamo bene, è un tempo direi di tutto rispetto, quindi un obiettivo abbastanza ambizioso. The very last one, l'ultima domanda, I make it in advance in Italian and then I pass into English, okay? L'ultima domanda è, ci sono molte persone che si avvicinano all'ultramaratona, è un movimento comunque in crescita, quantomeno in Italia, molti però magari lo fanno in maniera, se vogliamo, destrutturata, e quindi o magari si avvicinano troppo presto all'ultramaratona. Quindi quali sono i consigli per approcciare in modo giusto questo tipo di disciplina? I was saying that the number of people trying to practice the ultra marathon is growing, at least in Italy, is there is a good press around that, and many people are trying to enter it in this kind of sport. Mm-hmm. But there are sometimes some mistakes made by the fact that people are too in a hurry to get the result, and maybe don't do the right step in order to prepare their body progressively. So do you have any suggestion or any, which is the mistake that people don't have to make if while approaching the ultra marathon races?
It's difficult, right? Because everybody is different, and everybody will, I want to go to the top of Mount Everest. Why? Because it's the tallest in the world. I want to sail across the channel. Why? Because most difficult, whatever. So you can do whatever you want. But for me, longevity and sustainability comes from enjoying something, intrinsically enjoying it for the love of doing it. So gradually, by doing a little bit more, a little bit more, a little bit more, and training towards those things, will continue the joy, and you will not have setbacks, you won't get injured, you won't lose love of running. So it will be a constant progress curve, and to see the curve kind of quite straight and constantly up is much more satisfying and motivating than lots of setbacks where you question whether you're doing the right thing. So yeah, of course everyone wants to do whatever's available, it's crazy for me how many people have maybe a 5K or a 10K locally, and they don't want to maximize what they can do in this first before going up to the marathon. Everyone marathon, and it's become this corporate machine, right, of 50,000 people in London, 40,000 people in Amsterdam, and it's just fueled by people that, you know, you can get hurt. So you have to enjoy, for me, you have to enjoy it.
Okay. I tell you that is not the last question, because there is one even more important that we haven't done. And I would like just 1 minute more of your time to answer that. But no, Luigi Del Buono is making a new one. So, okay, the last two. Nietzsche. Per approcciare, ciascuno di noi è differente, quindi c'è gente che vuole salire sull'Everest perché è la montagna più alta, eccetera, eccetera. Importante è fare le cose gradualmente e progressivamente, perché questo rende, allunga i tempi in cui si può praticare uno sport, allunga la longevità sportiva, allunga il benessere della vita. Quindi facendo le cose progressivamente si può continuare a fare e ad amare quello che lo sport che si fa. Enjoy divertirsi, quindi fare le cose con leggerezza, con serietà, ma comunque trovare il modo di continuare a farlo divertendosi. Questo lo si fa in modo graduale, anche se ovviamente adesso c'è tutto il flusso delle grandi maratone, magari non è inusuale, e su questo Severio Fattore, se ancora collegato, sarà d'accordo, vedere gente che magari invece di consolidare un tempo sui 5.000 e 10.000 si butta subito nel voler fare una maratona. The last two questions, I do it simultaneously. One is the fuel plan, your fuel plan during the 100 km race, quindi l'integrazione che lui usa durante la 100 km, che of course is something personal, but just to have some top line, some qualche informazione particolare. And the second one from Luigi Del Bono is saying, in your opinion, the African athletes like Kenya, countries like Kenya and so on, that are expressing a lot of talents and champions in the marathon, will arrive to run the 100 kilometers, and there will be some sort of revolution of the personal best in also in this discipline. Let's think, for instance, to Eliud Kipchoge and Kenesis Abekele, and what they are doing with the marathon around the 2 hours.
Okay, so fueling plan, very simply, together with your training plan, you have to train the stomach to be able to take in gradually more and more carbohydrates. So the drinks fuel that I use is Morton, which is very famous now with all the top athletes and the cycling teams. But this has to come into the training. So you gradually have to train your stomach and the absorption to use that sugar, a multi-source sugar, and turn that into energy as quickly as you can. So you have to train with that. It can't be just for race day. So I take between 80 and 100 grams per hour, but it takes time for the stomach to get used to that. And then logistically, in a race like Il Pastore, how do you do that? If you have a guy on a bicycle, it's fine. But then if the course director is behind you and he's telling these are the new rules, you can only drink every drink station, when you know this is different for everybody else in the race, you have to change your tactic and be used to something else. So the key is, again, mentally, that could switch you off because you don't have access to your regular plan. So you have, again, solid. You have to be mentally solid, but your nutrition plan at the World Championships, for instance, will be very easy. Every 3K, every 6K, we will have a drink. So very, very simple. Very simple. Every 10 minutes.
Okay, so I translate this before, and then you will answer to the very last question from Luigi about the African people. Come per correre si allenano i chilometri, per l'integrazione in gara bisogna anche allenare lo stomaco progressivamente ad assumere nella maniera più facile possibile il miglior quantitativo possibile di carboidrati. Lui usa un tipo specifico di gel di integrazione che in questo momento va per la maggiore, ma è chiaro che poi questo deve essere accompagnata anche qui mentalmente, da una preparazione mentale di capire come poter fare ad assumere questi tipi di gel durante la gara, quindi se hai qualcuno che ti può accompagnare in bici in certi tipi di gare, o invece se devi prenderlo ai ristori o meno. Comunque l'importante è proprio, non solo nella gara ma anche nell'allenamento, abituare il tuo stomaco a prendere la maggior quantità possibile di gel o comunque di carboidrati che possano essere poi utilizzati come fuel, come combustibile durante la gara. Poi al campionato del mondo sarà molto semplice perché ci saranno dei giri da 7 km, quindi ogni 6-7 km si potrà prendere da bere, probabilmente poi ci saranno anche dei ristori intermedi ogni 3-4 km, quindi lì l'integrazione sarà molto semplice. What about the fact that Africans will come into the 100 km?
Generally speaking, but this is truth, you need the prize money. When you have the prize money, whether it's the 50K World Championships or whether it's 100K World Championships or world record, both of them will look ridiculous right now to what it could be. So the current world record for 50K is 2 hours 40, set by an African South African. If you're running 202 and you make that an easy 205, how easily can you do that last 8K? It's very, very simple. So I think 230 is very simple. So you're looking to late 220s, 228, 227. And then for 100K, again, like Eliud Kipchoge does two marathons a year because he has the luxury of being Nike's number one, yeah? But if you're doing 100K, how often can you do that every year? So the prize money has to be big enough for them just to race one or two times per year fast. So like maybe in Japan, when the record continually breaks over the last 30 years in Lake Saromo, can't remember, but the fast course in Japan, if you have the prize money, that's going below 6 hours quite easily. Yeah.
Okay, so the secret is the prize money. Il segreto un po' per far accadere quello che Luigi chiedeva, ovvero far avvicinare anche determinati atleti al mondo della 100 km è quello del Monte Premi, perché è chiaro che più è grande il Monte Premi e più appetibile diventa la gara. Una persona come Eliud Kipchoge vuole essere il numero uno al mondo, ad esempio in maratone, quindi corre due maratone all'anno. È chiaro che dovendo correre il record del mondo della 50 km 2 ore 40, probabilmente uno come Kipchoge o Bekele o anche tanti altri potrebbero farlo tranquillamente, ma poi dipende da come questo va a inficiare la loro, il resto della loro preparazione, eccetera, eccetera. Quindi nel momento in cui, diciamo, Kipkoge, per fare un esempio, ovviamente volesse avvicinarsi al mondo della 100 km, per renderglielo appetibile ci dovrebbe essere un montepremi di assoluto livello, e poi chiaramente anche lì i tempi potrebbero assolutamente cambiare, si potrebbe scendere facilmente sotto le 6 ore. The very last one, I promise, the very last one. Michele Bernomi is asking for an advice, because in mid-July he will run a 100 km in Sicily, the Ibla Major 100, from Caltagirone to Avola. Is a pretty new 100 km that we have in Sicily since a couple of years. It will be a very hot race, because the temperature in Sicily will be very hot in mid-July. He's asking for some advice, even from a mental perspective, to try to survive in this race.
Well, it's a good question, but it's the same for everyone, right? And yes, the race is only you against you. So from now until July, if I was him, I would be running when it's most hot during the day. So if he's working a full day, I'd be going running in 1 o'clock during the day and go and do your training sessions then. The same on in the long run, Saturday or Sunday, run in the heat. Make sure your hydration and your salt intake, electrolyte intake is trained, and your fuel strategy is even more than it would do usually. But train with that, what I just mentioned on the fuel. And then the beginning of the race should feel cool for you, which is what I felt coming into the last 30K. It felt cold. So you just have to adapt the body.
Ok, quindi Michele, quello che dice lì è molto semplice: il caldo ci sarà per te, ma ci sarà per tutti, e la corsa alla fine della fiera è solo te contro te, quindi se ci sarà caldo quel giorno tu preoccupati di fare tutti gli allenamenti possibili nelle ore più calde della giornata, in maniera tale da... Già lo fai, Miki, io lo so, ti conosco, quindi ti vedo che già lo fai. Quindi di allenarti nei momenti più caldi della giornata e di assicurarti che poi la tua integrazione, sali minerali, eccetera, siano reintegrati il meglio possibile. Lì, we are at the very end of this interview, of this speech.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for your availability. I apologize if it was longer than expected, there was really a lot of questions. So
yeah, grazie.
Maybe we can speak again. If you promise, sure. If I was not too bad, we can speak again along the year after the World Champion in Germany, okay?
Perfect. Yeah, perfect. That would be great. Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it.
Okay. Thank you very much. And see you soon. Ciao. Bye-bye.
Ciao.
Ciao. Buonanotte a tutti. Ciao, ciao.